Okay, while we're setting up, I just want to say hello to everyone online. I know there are people from all over the world joining, including folks from Australia, where it is at this point 4:12 a.m. So thank you for your commitment. We have some folks here as well. We're taping this, and we're going to hope this is sort of a continuation of a conversation where we see how we can pull various stakeholders of the university together. The university, I mean, in the bigger sense of the universitas, the efforts to create insights and knowledge to improve the state of the world, so to speak. And so thank you, David Sloan Wilson, for coming to us, being here with us. We had an interesting morning. We're going to develop a little bit more in the afternoon. This is sort of where you can share a lot more about the work that you have been recently doing. And so thank you very much for coming on. And yes, all yours.
Well, thank you, Michael. And we had indeed a very generative morning about both business plus more, including education. So there's loads of collaborative potential that I'm eager to explore, and for this talk to be part of setting the stage broadly. I want to begin. Oh, but now it's not sure. Let's see, on, I'm okay here. Maybe that's what all I need.
If you roll it.
Okay. And now how do I roll back? Oh man, wait a minute.
Did you hear?
Well, now it'd be awfully nice if I could use this, you know.
Right.
There we got all back. Wait a minute. Ah, looks like this is working now.
Okay.
Yeah, all right. Okay. So I want to begin with two Nobel laureates in economics. One is very well known to the business community, Milton Friedman, who famously said that there is one and only one social responsibility of business: to use its resources and engage in activities designed to increase its profits so long as it stays within the rules of the game. And Eleanor Ostrom, who was actually unknown to most economists when she won their most coveted prize. She's a political scientist by training, and who identified, it's working fine now, eight core design principles needed for groups to function well. And I will be dwelling upon these eight core design principles soon enough in my talk. So these different worldviews represent different ethical systems. Friedman's system is an ethical system. He was not saying that companies should maximize their profits no matter what the harm. He was saying that if they do, then they will be led as if by an invisible hand to benefit the common good. And so, and for this to be true, for it to function as an ethical system, then there are certain requirements. Anything of value can be represented as a monetary value. Values are related to each other through the adjustment of prices in a free market. The free market system therefore maximizes societal value. That's how a free market system can function as a moral system. In this system, competition is more or less unambiguously good, and the pursuit of lower level self-interest, individuals maximizing their utilities, companies maximizing their profits, robustly benefits the common good. This is said to be the first fundamental theorem of welfare economics. In Ostrom's view, unregulated competition within groups results in tragedies. Ostrom studied common pool resource groups drawing upon common pool resources, where the incentive to take more than your share results in the tragedy of overuse. Nevertheless, it turns out that groups can manage their own affairs, can avoid the tragedy of the commons, but only if they implement certain core design principles. These principles are scale independent. They're needed for relations among groups, in addition to relations within groups. And this I should call polycentric governance. So this is also an ethical system, but one that's very, very different than the one that Friedman offered. Next, we need to ask the question, what is the theoretical foundation upon which these two paradigms are based? And in Friedman's case, this is the rational actor model. But the whole set of assumptions that's fondly referred to as homo economicus concerning the nature of the human being and the nature of the economic environment in which it lives. And this whole conception, homo economicus conception, I like to say is famously unreal. It's been, that unreality has been commented upon from the very beginning. Here's a quote from Thorstein Veblen about its unreality. And smart thinkers throughout history have commented on the unreality of the assumptions underlying homo economicus. And somehow this has not prevented the paradigm from remaining a dominant position. Friedman himself, in his famous essay on positive economics, acknowledged its unreality and said that corporations behave as if these assumptions are true because the assumptions are manifestly untrue. Ostrom, on the other hand, in part as she developed it, and in part as it can be generalized, and I've played a role in that generalization, rests upon a very solid foundation of evolutionary theory and complex systems theory. It can be understood in terms of the dynamics of cooperation in all sorts of species. Our own evolutionary history is a highly cooperative species and goes beyond genetic evolution to include cultural and personal change as evolutionary processes. I'll be elaborating upon this next thing. But the point is that these two paradigms that we have, one is famously unreal and the other, I would like to say, stands upon a rock solid foundation. And so I really do think that these two worldviews count as different paradigms. And in the sense that Thomas Kuhn used the terms, configurations of ideas that are basically so different from each other that from going from one to the other is different than normal science within any particular paradigm. The neoliberal economic paradigm is well traveled, especially in the economic and business worlds, but it's the evolution complexity paradigm that we need to take. We need to take that path, not the other one. Now, I want to spend a few minutes as to why the evolutionary slash complexity paradigm is new, as I did this morning. And even though Darwin thought that his theory applied to all aspects of humanity in addition to the rest of life, during the 20th century, the study of evolution became constricted to genetic evolution. As if the only way for offspring to resemble their parents is by sharing genes. So around the world and for experts and novices alike, when I say evolution, most people hear the word genes. In biology textbooks, natural selection was defined as a change in gene frequency. And so the study of other kinds of change, cultural change and personal change, was ceded to other disciplines, other academic disciplines. And those disciplines, anthropology, sociology, psychology, all of the humanities, many schools of thought within each of those disciplines, developed into sophisticated bodies of knowledge, but largely without reference to each other, certainly without reference to evolution, and sometimes in perceived opposition to evolutionary theory. So this resulted in what I like to call a knowledge archipelago. And that metaphor for me is a powerful metaphor. The idea that knowledge is an archipelago of islands of thought with little communication among islands and the consequences of that. So I'll be coming back to that metaphor of a knowledge archipelago during my talk. The bottom line is that only during the last few decades has the study of evolution expanded beyond the study of genetic evolution to include any process with the three vital ingredients of an evolutionary process, namely variation, selection, and replication. Any variation, selection, replication process counts as an evolutionary process. And so that includes such things as epigenetic change, cultural change, personal change, symbolic system change. And so this is a very exciting time intellectually during the last few decades, and it touches upon every aspect of humanity, exactly as Darwin envisioned. And here's two books, great books, and note the dates, basically, 2006, 2015. The recency of this is something that I want to impress upon you. And then a similar story can be told for complexity, somewhat of a different story, that for people that are not explicitly theoretical, that are just like scholars studying complex systems, including human cultures, then of course they realize it's complex. They realize that in a given culture, for example, that everything is highly contextual. And so complexity is something which is not new. It's kind of in our face when we're studying something descriptively, but when we model it mathematically, starting with the origin of mathematics, and people like Isaac Newton, imagine how astounding it was back then for a system of mathematical equations to predict the orbit of the planets with such precision. I mean, the amazing power of mathematics. And of course, it's understandable that people who were thinking about human social systems, such as economic systems, would want to emulate that. But then wouldn't it be great if we had a physics of social behavior? Could we develop a mathematical framework, which was like Newton's laws of emotions? Of course, we can understand the appeal of that. But it took a while to realize the limitations of formal mathematical modeling, that constructing a system of equations requires making simplifying assumptions, which become extremely limited in their own right. And this is just as true for physical systems as it is for human social systems. So the very concept of being able to create a self-contained system of mathematical equations which predicts the real world is one which was ill-conceived, although it's taken a while to realize that, and also the tools to go beyond formal mathematical modeling did not exist before the advent of computing and the widespread availability of computing. And so right away, we're in the last quarter of the 20th century as to the advent of complex systems theory. Two great books, note the dates. The first popular book, one of the first popular books on chaos, The Making of a New Science, James Gleick. I remember reading it and being just profoundly impressed by it. 1987, and here's one of the first books that applies it to economics. Eric Weinhacher, still an important person in the field, whose book, The Origin of Wealth, 2006. So I want to impress upon you the recency of these two foundational theories, evolutionary theory and complex systems theory, for applying it to real world settings. And I always like to say that we get a double benefit from this worldview. On the one hand, we can be asking the deep philosophical questions about the nature of life and the human condition. What's the nature of morality? What's the nature of knowledge? What's the nature of religion? So these big questions, we can ponder them, but also, which excites me as much or even more, we can use these concepts as a practical toolkit in order to actually address the problems of life. And I love the metaphor of a toolkit. That's what a plumber or a carpenter takes with him to the job, sizes up the job, pulls out the right tools, gets the job done, and moves on to another job. Is there some way that we could use these two theories as a toolkit to actually improve the quality of life in any particular context? So that's what, and to be able to do both is, for those who get it, I mean, there can be no better, in my view, combination than that combination of to function at the practical level and at the deep philosophical level at the same time. So now what I want to do in my very, very brief talk, and of course, I get a chance to do it at better length in my book, This View of Life, Completing the Darwinian Revolution. I just want to give you a glimpse at some of these tools in Darwin's toolkit, and beginning with multi-level selection. And the best way for me to introduce that is with the game of Monopoly. You know it well. You know that the goal is for a player to capture all the real estate and drive the other players bankrupt. And so this is very much a process of competition among individuals within a single group, okay? So get yourself in a Monopoly mood. And now I'm going to change the rules. Now we're going to be playing in a Monopoly tournament. Many games are in play, and the trophy goes to the team that collectively develops their property the fastest. And I think that you will agree, just thinking about it a little bit, first, let me comment how intuitive both versions of the game are. The single game is intuitive, and the tournament is intuitive. But isn't it interesting that nearly every decision you make as a team player will be different than playing the regular game of Monopoly? I've actually done this with a science club, and it was so fascinating to actually witness the transition from the single game to the tournament, and then how different it was. And so this introduces the concept of multi-level selection. Evolution is like that. Natural selection within groups is like the single game of Monopoly, and it results in disruptive self-seeking behaviors. And this is so important that some renderings of evolution make it sound as if it results in just benign products. But no, evolution does not make everything nice. Evolution often leads to the problems of life, not to the solutions of life. There is something about natural selection, especially at the smallest scale of individuals interacting within single groups, that is disruptive. That is disruptive. That results in antisocial behaviors. Fortunately, natural selection does not operate only at that level. It operates at higher levels, such as between groups, like the Monopoly tournament. And it's there that we find an evolutionary force that results in teamwork, cooperation, coordination, and frankly, goodness in all of its forms. And so the message here, there's good news and bad news. The good news is that yes, we can explain altruism, cooperation, coordination, goodness in all of its forms as a product of evolution. Winning the Darwinian contest, the bad news is special conditions are required. It does not happen all the time. It does not spontaneously self-organize. It only happens when special conditions are met. And we can take what I've described, the two levels, within group selection and between group selection, and we can expand it to multi-level selection, because life, both human life and nature, consists of groups within groups within groups. And the logic that I've explained exists at every rung of this hierarchy. So what's good for me can be bad for my family. What's good for my family can be bad for my clan. What's good for me can be bad for my company. What's good for my company can be bad for the global economy. So this logic exists at all levels. Adaptation at any given level requires a process of selection at that level, and tends to be undermined by selection at lower levels. Not hard to understand, but profoundly different than the concept of the invisible hand, which pretends that the pursuit of lower level interests somehow robustly benefits the common good. That is deeply untrue. And it's deeply untrue in real world economic environments, despite the fact that in some hypothetical economic environments, then it might be true. Those hypothetical environments don't exist in the real world. And against that background, we can now we can revisit Eleanor Ostrom and her core design principles. Now, it's important to emphasize that Ostrom studied a certain kind of group, groups that are attempting to manage common pool resources such as forests or fisheries or fields, pastures, the groundwater irrigation system. These are called common pool resources because they're something that every member of the group can draw upon, which influences what's available to the whole group. And so received wisdom was that this tragedy will always occur unless you can privatize the resource or impose top-down regulation. And what Ostrom showed by actually studying common pool resources groups around the world was that actually some of them were able to manage their common pool resources, were able to avoid the tragedy of the commons, but only if they exhibited these core design principles. And so now let me list them, go through them very briefly. And as I do, please think about them with respect to the groups in your life, a business group or any other kind of group, and to see if these core design principles might also be relevant to those groups. So the groups that work, the groups that avoid the tragedy of the commons, had a strong sense of identity and purpose. They knew that they were a group, they knew what they were about, they knew that it was important, they knew who was a member, so on and so forth. Fair distribution of costs and benefits. Not sustainable for some members of the group to get the benefits while other members of the group do all the work. There must be some sense in which what you get from the group is proportional to what you give to the group. Fair and inclusive decision making. Not very sustainable if some members of the group do not take part in the decision-making process. In the first place, that's a recipe for unfairness. In the second place, it does not make use of the knowledge that all members of the group might have. Monitoring agreed upon behaviors. If we don't know that you're doing what you're supposed to do, then of course, all forms of non-compliance is possible, whether intended or not. Graduated sanctions for misbehaviors. What if you're not doing what you should? Something must be done, but it need not start out harsh. In fact, it should start out friendly and then only escalate when necessary. And I have to share Lynn Ostrom's story that she told again and again about this core design principle involving the lobster gangs of Maine. One of her favorite examples were, so Maine has all of these bays, and each bay is basically owned by a group of lobster fishermen. And those colorful buoys that are emblematic of Maine are actually have a function. They designate each individual lobsterman so that they know who's actually trapping lobsters in the bay. So what happens if some interloper comes in and sets lobster traps in a given bay? They know it immediately. What do they do? And what they do is they tie a bow around the buoy. And Lynn used to laugh about that. These big burly lobstermen will tie a bow around the buoy. So there's your graduated sanction. Gentle, friendly, and you know what will happen if the problem is not solved at that level. And so the most successful groups always had something like that. And we've added something that actually was a bit new against her background, and that is positive reinforcement for good behavior in addition to negative corrections for bad behavior. So the rule is abundant praise for good behavior coupled with mild punishment for bad behavior that escalates only when necessary. That's the recipe for the fifth core design principle. Fast and fair conflict resolution. Conflicts will exist. They need to be resolved quickly and in a manner that's regarded as fair by both parties. In a dispute, both parties think they have a point of view, and this must be dealt with quickly and respectfully. Number seven, authority to self-govern. If a group doesn't have the elbow room in order to manage its own affairs, then they can't do any of those previous things. And then finally, appropriate relations with other groups. These principles are scale independent, and so they're needed at all levels of a multi-tier hierarchy. They're needed for between group interactions in addition to within group interactions. And the next time you hear the news about the European Union or Brexit or the United Nations or any other large scale form of governance. Just think about these core design principles and see if in fact they're operating at that scale, all the way down to the scale of individuals within a team, a small team, such as the teams that are formed in the sophomore year of Fordham's business school. Now, I hope you can see just on the basis of this very brief introduction, how well the core design principles map on to multi-level selection theory. Namely, if you imagine a group that implements these core design principles strongly, imagine trying to play the single game of Monopoly. It won't be very easy. Now imagine a group which does not implement these core principles strongly. Imagine someone trying to play the single game of Monopoly. They could probably do so pretty easily. And so what these core design principles have done is that they basically suppressed the potential for disruptive self-serving behaviors within groups, intended or not. And there's many, many disruptive behaviors within groups that are not intended. The person is well-meaning. How they behave is disruptive. So we really have to separate intentions from actions when we think about disruptive behaviors. And so this is called a major evolutionary transition. If I had more time with you, I could tell you that in biological evolution, higher levels of organizations, such as nucleated cells and multicellular organisms, social insect colonies, and the first human groups that existed at a small scale, what distinguishes humans from other primates, were all the result of a shift in the balance of selection, suppressing the potential for disruptive self-serving behaviors within groups and causing the group to be the primary unit of selection. That's what happened for the major evolutionary transitions of life. That's also what happens in each and every group when you implement these core design principles. You've accomplished a miniature cultural major transition, so that enables that group to function more like a team than they would otherwise. And it's really important to make this point relating ethics and efficacy. Because these principles are so much about equity and fairness, they count as a miniature ethical system for the group, but they also make the group efficacious, capable of accomplishing its collective goals better than they did before. So it's not the case that when we teach ethics in business schools, and the kind of an implicit assumption is, okay, by being ethical, that's somehow going to detract from our bottom line. There's a very strong sense in which becoming more ethical as an organization also makes you more efficacious as an organization, and therefore contributes to your bottom line, although only in a certain kind of social environment that's rewarding cooperation. Okay, that's not inevitably the case, but it can be the case with a suitably socially constructed environment at the multi-group level, in addition to within groups. And so when we generalize the core design principles, we can make a bold prediction that what Ostrom showed for one kind of group should hold for all types of groups, no matter what the type of group, a school, a church, a business, a neighborhood, a family, a couple. N=2 is the smallest group size that you can have. Then, first of all, these groups will vary from the best to the worst, and we know that's true based on common experience. And this morning we were talking about how the teams formed in the sophomore year of your business school vary from the best to the worst, but also that variation can be largely explained by the implementation of the core design principles. And there's no reason on earth why business groups should be different than any other kind of group in this regard. So the whole concept that business is played according to a different set of rules is being called into question here. And as part of my research agenda, working with my own PhD students, is to test this hypothesis. And with one of my students named Mel Phillips, we've conducted a survey. Here's some of the results. And so in this survey, individuals were asked to bring a group to mind that they know well, and then to evaluate whether that group functions well or poorly with a number of group performance metrics, and then to separately evaluate how well that group implements the core design principles, and to do that twice, once for a workplace group, a place of employment, and again for any other group in their lives that they've cared. So we're explicitly comparing business groups with any other kind of groups in this study. And so here's a sample of the results. On the x-axis, we have how well the group implemented the core design principles. On the y-axis, an index of group performance, which in this case is trust. And what we see are, in the first place, a great fit. So the groups vary along the x-axis from the best to the worst. And a lot of that variation is explained by, they vary on the y-axis from the best to the worst. A lot of that variation is explained by the x-axis, the implementation of the CDPs. Second, we see the business groups in blue fit the same curve along with any other kind of group. So businesses need the same core design principles as well as any other kind of group. And number three, we see that if we look at the top of that line, the high functioning groups, we see blue points. So some business groups function very well, thanks to the fact that they implement the core design principles. But as we work our way down to the dysfunctional end of the graph, we see a preponderance of business groups. So as a class, business groups are functioning less well than other kinds of groups based on the fact that they're failing to implement the core design principles. Or we can break this down and look at them principle by principle. And what we find is that business groups are deficient in all of them, but we can rank them. The biggest deficit is in the seventh core design principle, local autonomy. In other words, many people at their workplaces cannot do their jobs as they fit. Okay. The second biggest deficit is decision-making. Many people in their jobs feel that they are not part of the decision-making process. And the third biggest deficit is a sense of identity and purpose. Many people in their jobs don't feel that their work is meaningful and that their companies are doing something that is meaningful. They lack a sense of meaning. And so there's deficits in all eight, but those are the three biggest deficits. Now, this is one study and it's a survey study. And so you might think that it's just like, you know, how seriously should we take it? But frankly, once you see the business and management world through the lens of the core design principles, then you read the business and management literature, the evidence is everywhere, in my opinion, so much so that it's almost as if a single study, you don't need to do a single additional study once you view the evidence through the right lens. Adam Grant's great book, Give and Take, he says there's three business strategies. There's the givers, give, 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 the takers, take, 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 and the reciprocators, the matchers. I'll give, but only if I know that I'm going to get. I'm going to make sure that that calibration takes place. And he asked the question, who does best in the business world? And the answer is the givers do the best and the worst. When givers get together with other givers, the results are spectacular. When they don't, then they become doormats and suckers. And so that's exactly what you'd expect from this multi-level perspective. This book by Jeffrey Pfeffer of the Stanford Business School, 1998. So it's 20 years old, crushes you with evidence about the benefits of companies doing the right thing by putting their people first. One study that's cited in this is a survey of companies from the time they went public on the stock exchange, so you could gather information about them, and then tracking them for 5 years to see how many companies were just still standing after 5 years. In other words, this is the real survival of the corporation. There was a huge effect of how well the companies did by their employees. What were their employee practices? And so the basic survival of the company is dependent upon basically CDP2, proportional cost and benefits. And this really, for me, illustrates this point that so much depends on your world view, how you see the world, the lens through which you see the world, which can be a scientific lens or any. We all have worldviews of one sort or another that organizes our perception. As Einstein said, it's the theory that decides what can be observed. And so if your lens is the Friedmanian lens, then that's going to organize your perception. The Ostromian lens, it just makes so much sense, or more generally, the evolution complexity, so much becomes common sense that was obscured or denied before. So the theory decides what can be observed. Just changing the worldview is transformative, even before you act on the basis of that. So I'm sure that this article in the New York Times came to your notice several months ago. When I first read it, I thought it could be the title of an Onion article. Shareholder value, no longer everything, top CEOs say. Well, one thing that this tells you is that, yes, this idea that the main business of a corporation is to make money for a shareholder is taken very seriously. It is. And so now these CEOs are saying, we're not going to do that anymore. And questions arise. Is it, first of all, are you serious? And secondly, well, if you're really not going to do it anymore, what are you going to do? What's plan B? What's plan B? And I'm here to say that there is a plan B, that there is another path, another paradigm. And it's not, I mean, it's pretty well developed, actually. We really have a kind of a game plan where we can go down that other path. And so that's very exciting. But it's only half the story. So now I have to do a time check. How are we doing on time?
12:45.
Good. Okay. Because I've been talking about adaptedness, how a company or any group can be well adapted to its circumstances and especially configured for cooperation in all of its forms, but I have not yet said much about adaptability, the ability of any entity, an individual or a group, to actually change in response to a changing environment. Those are different things, and so it's good to know that the evolution complexity paradigm also provides tools for increasing adaptability in addition to adaptedness. And here are some of the books that I've been involved in. And this figure here, this four quadrant figure, I will be describing in more detail. So to make this distinction, so the core design principle is an adaptive organization to its current environment. Extra set of principles is required to adapt to changing environments. We know that change is difficult as individuals. Every year we make our New Year's resolution and every year we fail to keep them. And so the idea that we have some valued direction and we're just gonna move in that valued direction, it doesn't happen at the individual level, and it also does not happen at the organizational level. So it's not enough to outline these core design principles and just think that the organization is gonna take straightforward steps. Not that simple. So how can evolutionary theory make businesses become more adaptable? And so there's two major sources of dysfunction that really are highlighted from an evolutionary perspective. The first is that behaviors are actually adaptive in the evolutionary sense of the word, but not in the normative sense of the word. I'll elaborate on that in just a minute. And then also behaviors that are mismatched to their current environment and are maladaptive in every sense of the word. So the concept of evolutionary mismatch, that the ways that we're behaving, not just genetically, but culturally and personally, were adapted to some past environment, but are not adapted to our current environment. Now we need change in every sense of the word. So two different kinds of dysfunction, both must be understood from an evolutionary perspective. So once again, I think that maybe this is f- familiar by now, evolution doesn't make everything nice, often results in basically benefits to lower level entities, but that are disruptive up the scale. So self-preservation, that's a good thing until it becomes self-dealer. Helping your family, a good thing until it becomes nepotism. Helping your friends, a good thing until it becomes cronyism. Growing your national economy, a good thing, except it heats the earth. And so it's implicit in multi-level selection theory that if any lower level unit becomes well adapted to its environment, that might be, in fact, well could be disruptive up the scale. And so as individuals and as groups, we find ourselves doing these things. Evolution has driven us to do it, but it's part of the problem, not part of the solution. And so unless we can manage this process, unless we can manage the process of cultural evolution, so it becomes aligned with our normative goals, then we're done. So we must become wise managers of evolutionary processes. This top picture here, I don't know how well you can see it. What it is, it's a male beetle trying to mate with a beer bottle. And this beetle, as you can see, it's elytrate, it's hard wing covers. See those dimples? And so that's what it evolved to search out, beetles with dimples. That's how it searches out females. Unfortunately for it, that beer bottle also has dimples. And so that's the biggest, sexiest female that this male beetle has ever seen. So there's a great example of evolutionary mismatch, maladaptive in every sense of the word. And you know, there's so many examples of this kind of mismatch in our lives that we have to be able to recognize. And I've just put up a slide of the obesity epidemic as an example of this, but we are awash with mismatches, and we've created mismatches not only for ourselves, but for every species on Earth, because we live in the Anthropocene. We've impacted every species on Earth. Think of microplastics. It's just one of an infinitude of examples. We change the environment in a way that's impacting every single species on Earth and creating these mismatches. And so are there methods for addressing these? And thankfully the answer is yes. At the individual level, this is called therapy and training. And I was so happy that Sophia is interested in mindfulness and has a background in mindfulness. I work with Stephen C. Hayes, who founded a version of mindfulness-based therapy called acceptance and commitment therapy. He's a real rock star in his world, and I'm privileged to be working with them. And so these can be, same techniques can be used to increase the adaptability of organizations. And I'll spend you just a little bit of time showing you how that works. First, the distinction between therapy and training. If you're highly distressed, you need therapy. But no matter what your skill level, you can benefit from training. So even the most elite athletes benefit from training. And the same principles are at play here, regardless of your current level of functioning. So you can call it therapy, you can call it training. The point is that no matter what your current skill level, you can get better based on these principles. And this is very evidence-based. And this technique, which basically increases, typically is called flexibility in the literature, but flexibility and adaptability are one and the same. And here's over 300 randomized control trials to date, showing that acceptance and commitment therapy training is useful for this whole constellation of problem behavior. We really have something important here that has been tested by science. Some versions of mindfulness kind of stray into the woo-woo realm, but this is very, very science-based. I just want to give you one example, which I love. The subjects were public school teachers responding to a wellness program. Basically, they were experiencing burnout. 75% were above clinical cutoffs for general mental health, depression, anxiety, or stress. It's a randomized waitlisted treatment, which means that the subjects were divided into two groups at random. One group does the intervention immediately, the other group waits, and then there's a pre, post, and follow-up period. And the intervention was just to read a book. No therapist, no human. Just a book on acceptance and commitment training. And what we find is, for the first group, we get they're scoring high which means a high degree of stress and anxiety. Post, they've gotten better. Then the waitlisted treatment, they more or less stay the same until they read the book, and then they get better. But for me, what I love about this graph is the difference between post and follow-up for that first group, post and follow-up. So before they read the book, after they read the book, and then nothing happens. They could have stayed the same. They could have relapsed, but they got still better. They got still better. So what can that mean? What that means is that they have internalized something. It is stuck with them, and now they've continued to practice it and get better. Just by reading a book. Just by reading a book. And this can happen in minutes or in very short interventions. And we should expect this from an evolutionary perspective. Think of gene therapy, for example. Our genotypes are enormously complex, thousands of genes. It is still the case that if we know what to do, we can surgically change a single gene and cause the whole phenotype to do better. Needn't take long as we know what to do. Now think of our symbolic systems as like that. In addition to our genes, we also have a whole symbolic system that influences how we behave. Very complex. Nevertheless, if we know what to do, and if we change just a little part of that symbolic system, we can change how you see the world, how it results in action. Needn't take a long time. A single metaphor might do it. And do you know that religion operates in that way? So this needn't take a long amount of time. And a lot of mindfulness-based therapy is based on meditational practices and Buddhist practices, Christian meditational practices. So there's a deep affinity and works largely through metaphors. So there's a deep affinity between mindfulness-based practices and religious, spiritual practices that I know that is dear to the hearts of people here being a Jesuit Catholic setting. So there's much to talk about what role spirituality plays, religious formulations of spirituality versus secular forms of spirituality, concepts such as soul, sacred, these things, what do they mean? Is there some way that we can talk about them and have that be meaningful to people from a broad range of cultural backgrounds, all part of what we're talking about this. So time check again, we're okay here?
If you want to get some into question, then maybe 10 more minutes?
Yeah, I can easily do that. So here's this very fast tool called the matrix. And it's basically sets the stage for a four-part reflection. On the bottom half, it's everything that's mental, all your values and beliefs and everything that's in your head cannot be seen, but it's very important. It's your symbolic world, you might say. On the top half, everything you can see, the actions that take place in the world. On the right half, all the things that take you towards your value goals, your normative goals. And on the left, all the things that take you away from your value goals. And typically we begin at the bottom right to basically an exploration of values. Let's just bring out, why is this important to me? What's important to me as an individual? What's important to us as a group? Why does it make a difference? Okay, and we move up to the top right. How would we act to fulfill those values? There's our normative goals. This is how we want to behave. We move down to the lower left quadrant and we ask, isn't it curious that despite the fact that this is important to us, that there's other things in our head that get in the way, that are obstacles, and that we don't want to conceal those or suppress them. We actually want to face them. That's the acceptance part of acceptance and commitment training. We accept the problems that we have, and we accept the fact that that you can't shed these necessarily. These are something that might always be with us. And we move up to the left top. How do these manifest as behaviors that take us away from our value goals? And then having explored these four quadrants, you now you put yourself in the middle of that, and that's how you interpret your world. That's how you interpret your world. Am I making an away move or a toward move? How can I make sure as I'm behaving in the moment, then I'm gonna make sure that I'm trying to reinforce these things up at the top right and avoid doing the things at the top left. So this was developed mostly for individuals, but it works just as well for groups. And here's an actual matrix that was filled out for a community radio station. So this is what was actually filled out. And as you might imagine, a community radio station, very communitarian. Everyone who works for one, very communitarian. Everyone well-meaning. Still the group wasn't functioning well. And this really reminds us the difference between intentions and actions. I've worked with so many groups that were well-meaning as groups and well-meaning as individuals, and still they didn't work well. It's not a matter really of cheaters as we often think of them, although that can happen too. So bottom right, what is important about this station? Why are we here? What values does it represent? And we see all these communitarian values. What would we do on that basis to really fulfill these values? You get what we see up at the right. But why is it that despite this, that we have all this kind of garbage that we're carrying around inside our heads and also in some of our social interactions? And then we get such things as lack of communication, unclear decision-making, feeling invisible, micromanagement, strengths not being made use of, sexism, unequal or disproportional rewards, lack of resources, personality conflicts. And I think you can see when you look at those is that how many of those are actually bring the core design principles in mind. And when we work with groups, we do this first before we introduce the core design principles. But as part of this reflection, the failures of the core design principle just kind of come bubbling up because they're part of the problem. And I think you can also see that what's on the left is actually, in most cases, adaptive in the evolutionary sense of the word. That, for example, fear or anger or all of these things in some sense reflect individuals getting their way within the organization, or perhaps protecting themselves within the organization. And so in a very, very limited sense, within the group, this represents some kind of adaptive kind of behavior, but one which is not aligned with the welfare of the group. And so what the exercise does, which is not done once, but what becomes repeatedly, so the matrix gets used again and again and again, it becomes a kind of a tool for aligning your personal and organizational evolutionary process with your valued goals. That's the idea of it. Okay, so I'm almost to an end here. So what we've done with our particular change method, pro-social, is to combine these two major tools, basically the mindfulness-based tool plus the core design principle tool, to work with groups of all types in a manner that can be scaled up. And just a few take-home messages here. I want to repeat the point that this paradigm has been developed to a considerable degree. This, in some sense, this is not future tense, this is present tense for actually a sizable community, but still a tiny, tiny fraction of where it needs to go. So that's a very important to be made. Little known by businesses, little taught in business schools. How do we catalyze this? One, by working directly with businesses. Two, by changing the business school curriculum. I'm starting to do this with John Haidt at the Stern Business School. We call it the Corporate Culture Collaborative. And basically it involves working with organizations that really want to take this on, and they want to work with scientists to help us manage their cultural evolution. And I got to tell one story about this, because part of this is just flat out implementing good scientific methodology. And one thing John's story John tells is that when Starbucks had its racial moment in one of its stores, and then it closed all of its stores for a day of diversity training. How many thousands would that be? Many thousands. Here's what it could have done. It could have tested the five most promising diversity training methods against each other in one of the largest randomized control trials in history. What it did do was just use one method of diversity training, and therefore it learned nothing from the experience. Doing it the right way would have cost no more money than doing it the wrong way, but they just didn't have that mindset. They just didn't have that mindset. And so part of this is actually to create that mindset with businesses. And some do. I mean, some really get it. Our first client is Shopify, which is one of the largest online marketing companies, valued at $50 billion. It's second to Amazon.com in online marketing. And the person that we're working with is just completely sold, basically, on this idea of using his corporation both internally and in relation to the larger economy as this wonderful way to experiment in real world settings. And so I've learned here at Fordham that, of course, as most business schools, have your own consortium of businesses that work with you. And so I think there's all kinds of potential for this idea of a corporate culture collaborative. Let it be as large as possible. Let multiple business schools join it. Please let's not have territoriality or ownership or anything like that. Let's go this working directly with corporations as much as possible. And of course, let's do this by revising the business school curriculum. And that's an initiative that's just waiting to begin. That's not happening anywhere, to my knowledge, including not at Stern, despite the fact that this corporate culture collaborative. And so my conversations with Michael have been along those lines. And the opportunities for cultural transmission, I think, are exceptionally good here. In the first place, you have your humanistic management group. That's one social network. And some of our friends here participating by Zoom are part of that network. And then you have the whole Jesuit and Catholic network capable of spreading best practices along these lines. So I think there's exceptional opportunities there. Now I have a final point to make. I hope I'm not overstaying my welcome at this point. It's a little bit subtle, but very, very important to me. So here's the graph I showed you earlier, and I emphasized the preponderance of points on the dysfunctional end of the scale. But if we work our way up to the functional end of the scale, we find lots of blue points. And so lots of businesses are doing things right. And I like to think of this as convergent cultural evolution, is that the business world is highly competitive. The idea of creative destruction does exist. Businesses do go under, succeed or fail, based on how they do things. And based on that fact, then the core design principles and adaptability principles have arisen not just once, but many times within the business world. You don't have to go outside the business and management literature to find great examples of everything that I've been talking about. And I wouldn't be at all surprised as everyone here is listening to my talk, they'd say, well, is this really new anyhow? Isn't there some sense in which at least this is already taking place? And the answer to that question is yes. I could have listed many more books in addition to this one. So that's good, but it's not good enough. Why is it? If you look at every one of these best practices, what you find is, in the first place, they originated more or less by happenstance and then spread on the basis of its success, but only to a degree, and time was taken for that. Even something as fabled as Toyota, with its continuous improvement methods, has taken 70 years to spread to its current point. Well known by some, especially in a business school setting, but I talk to all kinds of audiences. And if I start talking about Toyota, what fraction of people do you think know anything about it or how it works or why it could be considered an evolutionary process? A tiny, tiny fraction. And then there's other methods that arise in the business world. One I love is is rapid results. Who over here has heard of the rapid results method? Okay. It converges on the same principles. And so what you have are these multiple origins, but they don't generalize. And so there is a huge, my final point, there's a huge added value of a unifying theoretical framework that we can talk about this in a language which can be applied across all domains, all groups, all kinds. That's priceless compared to many other methods that actually do work, but cannot be described in this universal language. So this is not just the 101th change method. This is a change method which actually explains other change methods and can be respectfully combined with other change methods in a really collaborative relationship that we cultivate. So we don't regard ourselves as competitors with other change methods. We want to compare and assess and collaborate. And now at last, I am done. So thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you very much, David. This is great. And just for people that are here, any kind of quick reactions, questions that you might have, or things that you see?
I wanted to ask, the example of the lobster fishermen putting the bows around the buoys that, I'd like to reframe that as, you know, the lobster fishermen saying, oh, that's a very nice buoy you have there. It would be a shame if something happened to it. and
that's exactly right, by the way. I didn't mean to imply anything different.
Oh, okay. So, and you're calling it a mild consequence, and I think that should be, this. If you're on the receiving end, it's not a mild consequence, and there is what to discuss about how ethical it is as well. And missing, or not missing, but I don't see discussed in the core design principles enough about who's the gatekeeper for who's allowed into the group, or who do we reject from the group?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's morally problematic. I think that the thing about multi-level selection is that what counts as altruistic and cooperative within a group then can become aggressive and competitive at the level of between group interactions all the way up and down the scale. And the lobster are gangs of Maine. Actually, you know, that word gang is pretty appropriate. They're like a street gang that owns a bay, except rather than owning a neighborhood. And so that exclusion can be problematic in addition to the fact that they're capable of managing their resources. So it's not necessarily benign. And when we talk about graduated sanctions, I call it friendly, and it is friendly. So I think that often just imagine, and I study religion for 20 years now, I've studied religion from this perspective. And I made a study of the Hutterites, which is, of course, a communal Anabaptist sect on which a lot has been written. And there's one text which describes their procedure for handling transgressions. And I'm sure it'll be familiar to you. It also takes place in any real world setting. So somebody, you know, Martha is not doing what she's supposed to do and what she's agreed to do. So what do we do at first? In the first place, let's give her the benefit of the doubt. I mean, all of us are busy doing other things and so on. And if we're not doing what we should, maybe just don't infer bad intentions. But at the same time, something has to be done. So it's just a matter of, in a friendly way, talking it over with the person. A brotherly admonition is enough to me, as the Hutterites would put it. But then if nothing changes, then something more must take place. And if it happens again and again and again, we have to have some kind of discussion. And again, still, you're not necessarily a bad person, but if you're if you just cannot do these things that you're supposed to do in this group, maybe you shouldn't be in this group. And then in religious terminology, it is that, you know, you cannot let poison like this remain within the church. Exclusion is the only thing. But then always with the hope of return, repentance. And then if you repent and accept what's put upon you, and then we welcome you back into the church and all sins are forgiven. Because what you're trying to do is exterminate the behavior, not the person. You're punishing the behavior, not the person. And I do think that there's something benign about that. If you separate the behavior from the person, then and you distinguish between a bad behavior and a bad person, then I think there is something benign about it.
It could be a hairbreadth away from a witch hunt. And
absolutely, and it turns in that direction, especially with respect to between group interactions all the time, and the more dire the circumstances. So I'm not trying to put a gloss on this. So one of my most esteemed colleagues is named Michelle Gelfand, and she studies a distinction between tight and loose culture. The tight culture has strong norms, strongly enforced by punishment, and a loose culture provides much more flexibility for individuals to do what they want within the culture. And this distinction is basically, they're adapted to different environmental circumstances. And the main axis of environmental variation is existential security. So if you're in an existentially insecure situation, in other words, you and your entire culture is in danger of extermination, then that requires incredible solidarity. And to transgress under those circumstances, and that's super harsh. So that's what we associate with fundamentalism and all of its forms. And the loose end of the continuum is much more, but it requires a degree of existential security. And if you look at the geographical distribution of fundamentalism and more secular or more progressive forms of religion, shading into just non-religion, then it's as you would expect. And there's tons of literature on that topic. But I hope that I've conveyed in the first place, looking at this it's the only way to see moral systems. And then when you see them this way, then they're problematic in all sorts of different ways. And so it's very complex that way, but anyhow.
There are people online that may have questions. If you want to just unmute yourself.
Sean Turnbull, I remember you.
Yes, yeah,
I remember you.
David, I don't hear you yet.
David, terrific presentation.
I don't know what to do about that.
My comment is...
If you can hear us, we cannot hear you at this point.
I'm sorry. Hearing. You can't hear me? I unmuted myself. Can you hear me? Hello?
Hey, David. The rest of us offline can hear you.
This says mute on.
Hello.
Mute off here. See what happens there.
Sean, can you try again?
Yes. Hello. Can you hear me? I can see my microphone is.
Apologies for that technological snafu.
You can't hear me.
Oh. There are
chat messages.
Where are they?
Yeah, you can read out my first chat message.
If we quit out of the, let's stop the screen sharing.
Stop share. Oh, okay, so there are.
Chat.
Sean, can you type it?
Yes, it's in the chat message. My question, in the chat.
All right.
There is room for improvement in terms of these setups. So thank you for the patience. Sorry, Shan. I think this is at this point.
Okay, here's a book suggestion, The Birth of the Chaotic Age. It describes the stakeholder control bottom-up organization. See if you can get it to,
sure.
There we go. Okay.
It's this speaker, right?
Pretty much anyone coming in.
It's Sean. Oh, yeah, I mean, they've muted, but Sean was not muted. And
hello, you can't hear me? Hello.
We cannot hear incoming sound.
I'm holding up the book.
Michael, can
he
you hear me?
He says that he isn't muted.
Yes, that's right.
Hello.
So
can anyone else talk just to see if
so I've started talking just to see if you can hear me.
Because I think it might be on his end.
Sean, take out your headphones.
Can you hear me?
Oh.
Noemi, can you talk?
I can hear.
Is that better? No headphones.
Any questions popping up here, in addition. Yeah. Okay, Sophia.
This is Kurt Rydell. I'm talking. So, can you hear me?
If we're trying to get organizations or groups that don't operate this way to adopt this new worldview or paradigm, under like what circumstances do you find groups to be ready and prepared to shift this way? Is it the leader? Is it a moment of crisis? Is it what causes the impetus for this
gestalt shift? Yeah, so that's a great question, and one that kind of needs multiple answers, because I work with so many different kinds of groups, and so which includes the business world plus more. And so many groups are just start out very communitarian, egalitarian, all about cooperation and so on and so forth. And so they would be oriented towards this more so than a group that starts out with an ethos of top-down management or all of that. And so I think in that sense, what you'll find is working with something like a volunteer group, a nonprofit, a neighborhood, their starting point is better. If we look at businesses, we find plenty of those businesses. We have the whole B Corp movement that understand basically the concept of a company as a solid citizen in a larger ecosystem, a company that's trying to do well by its own employees and so on. So there's no lack of companies to work with. Another thing that can be said, I think, which is really important as an entree to businesses, is that no matter what the business philosophy or ethos, everyone works on teams. I mean, you just gotta, huh? And so if you can introduce this at the level of small teams and prove it at that level, then you can begin to expand it up. And there you encounter a problem that I've heard again and again, is that companies, when they do employ teamwork, such as lean and agile or any number of approaches that favor teamwork, it's mostly at lower levels of the organization. When in fact, it's the upper level that needs it as well. But there you get the powerful members of the group that really do not want to relinquish.
Can you come to 309?
Relinquish control. And so this happens again and again. And the book there that's so insightful is, I briefly listed it, it's A Team of Teams by General Stanley McChrystal, who was a head of the US forces in Iraq and Afghanistan when Al-Qaeda came on. And so here, the mightiest military force on earth blew into Iraq in a matter of days with conventional warfare, and then was faced with a new enemy that was beating them. Reconfigured the armed forces. In the first place, it consisted of teams that were as nimble as the small groups that they were as combating. And for that, they had a much more autonomy than in a military judgment. They had to make their decisions right then and there, and then you might evaluate. But that wasn't good enough. He had to make a team of teams, because those teams underneath the standard military hierarchy wasn't good enough. And so he amazingly managed to
Can other people from the chat hear me?
Robinson, I think the better Robinson's first name. Exactly that thesis at the National Center.
Yes, I heard you.
Hey!
Here we go.
Wait, no, hold on. No.
He may have to set his microphone.
He has to set his microphone. Wait, I think he...
Shan, can you hear us?
Yes. He can hear us.
We somehow cannot hear you.
So, I mean, that's true.
Okay, Shan, if you can type it, I think that's probably the only way.
So many books that when you read them, they have some vocabulary of their own, but they map onto this. And I really want to acknowledge this. So there's a sense in which this is both old and new.
Really old.
Really old. Yeah.
Okay. Any other?
Okay.
I just sort of see a continuum in sort of my lifetime going from like society being more forgiving and understanding to more litigious and unforgiving. And it just feels like it's just an unstoppable momentum, like it's just escalating. And I think somewhere in the problem in turning it around is that ideas are learned by individuals and not by groups. And in order for this something more forgiving, we sort of have to hold hands and trust each other and walk this back.
Sean, can you speak just so we can see if we can hear you?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yay. Stephen, I'll get that. But now we have a chance to try to... Hello, we spent time together in London.
Yeah, terrific, and terrific lecture. Thanks, David. The point I wanted to suggest is you use the term multi-level hierarchy, and there's another word called holarchy, which is quite different from... It's coined by Coaster, and it reflects your Russian doll idea that there's organizations within organizations, up from the personal level up to the national and to the global level. And the problem you have with introducing these ideas is all business schools and management schools implicitly assumed you're in a top-down command control power structure. And so all command and control is antithetical to all the core design principles that are promoted by Ostrom. So unless you turn the power structures upside down, you're not going to get the adaption and the variation and the selection that are essential for survival of organizations. So that's you ought to talk about it offline sometime.
No, that's an important point to make. By hierarchy, I do not mean chain of command, by no means. I agree with you totally. So I probably should avoid the use of hierarchy. What I mean there is that life consists of groups within groups within groups. So it's multi-level, but that doesn't mean that the top-down imposes top-down control, quite the opposite. And when we look at such things as holacracy, there's a whole literature there. Also, there's a fascinating method called sociocracy, which we've learned quite a bit about. And it's fascinating. These are, and now you've pointed out this book that you, thank you very much. That's a new one for me. I mean, to say a little bit more about Ostrom's concept of polycentric governance, that concept is, here it comes, life consists of many spheres of activity. Each sphere has an optimal scale. Therefore, good governance requires finding the optimal scale for each sphere and appropriately coordinating among the spheres. Stated that way, it can scarcely be otherwise, but it's not at all the top-down that you were talking about. Okay, I'm not going to try to read that. So anyhow, I agree with you wholeheartedly about very interesting forms of governance. And at the same time, it's very important to stress that every group needs structure, and the larger it becomes, the more structure it needs. So somehow this idea of not command and control has to be reconciled with the need for some kind of structure, therefore some kind of leadership. There's lots to tell leaders, but of course it needs to be of the cooperative leadership. Basically, the leader is functioning as a moderator. Sometimes it's called a servant leader, and so on. The leader is always gathering feedback. There has to be a whole bunch of bottom-up control in addition to top-down control. So that all of that has to be coordinated. And people, of course, are required to do that, and that makes them leaders, doesn't it?
But it's no, it's not, may I interject? Not leadership, it needs changes in the constitution of the organizations, their power structure is to give voice to stakeholders, to give voice to workers, give voice to communities. And that needs to be embedded in the power structure of corporate constitutions. You don't need any change in the law because we do have bottom-up stakeholder controlled governance like in the Visa International, the John Lewis Partnership and Mondragon. So it's not just leadership is useless if you don't have the power.
If I could play that back, I think what you're saying is it's not enough to have leaders have authoritarian power and hope that they do the right thing. There has to be some distribution of power. We agree.
Can I just ask the ones that are online if it is okay that we put this video up later on YouTube? If there's somebody that is against that, please let me know, send me an email. Thank you. Okay, great. We're at 1:30. We also want to be mindful of the biological needs of David, and there is food and lunch and a break, and then there's going to be another session at 2. If I were collectively try to see what we can do together in terms of the research more. So I want to thank you, David.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. And thank you for folks online. To be continued.
Great.
Thank you.